back from the dead.
It's the first Friday of the month, which in Vegas means the first Friday is like this huge, the Art District, which is kind of off. It's actually right by Zach's Museum. It's off Charleston and the 15, and it's like all the Vegas locals get together, and it's kind of like a big party for the night. But you know, as a local, you don't gamble much, you don't really drink a lot, and so everyone is just kind of hanging out, like buying art, like shopping for art. There's like multiple stages where local musicians are playing music, tons of food, tons of people, and so much fun. So if you're ever in Vegas on the first Friday of the month, go check out the Art District. It's called literally First Friday on the Art Walk, and it's so much fun. Anyway, I'm like super hyped up because we just got back from the Art District, and it's so much fun to be around like a bunch of creative like minds. What's up, guys? Welcome back to my channel, and today we're going to discuss probably one of the most asked questions that I get. And you know, I'm hoping that this video not only reaches my regular subscribers, but like other people that are having problems that, you know, if you Google search, my house is haunted, what do I do? There's not a lot that comes up. So I got another question. I actually got an email from a really concerned viewer, and she was like, I think I have an attachment, or I think something's in my house, or I don't know if it's to me or to an item in my house or to my kids, but can you help me? What do you do when you think you're haunted or you think that your house is haunted? The most typical thing that I get when you guys write me and ask me these questions is something's going on in my house or something's going on around me, and am I crazy? Am I losing it? Is it real? Should I believe that it's real? You know, sometimes haunts can be as real as you walking down the street and a stranger walks up to you and slaps you in the face. And so my question to you, theoretically, if you were walking down the street and a complete stranger walked up to you and slapped you in the face, what would you do? I mean, obviously, I'm assuming most of us wouldn't allow it to happen. I don't mean reacting in violence. I don't want to know like your details and how you'd like punch them back. I mean, you wouldn't allow it to happen, right? If someone enters your space, enters your comfort zone, even if it's a family or a family friend that you don't like in your house or in your space, what do you do? The answer is you get them out of your space. You don't allow them in your house. You don't allow them in your space. So my question for you is, if you don't allow people that are alive in your space that you don't like, why are you allowing dead people in your space that you don't like? It's as easy as that. So the first, sadly, you know, we've all done it. I'm guilty of doing it. Like the first thing you revert to when you have noises in your house or movement or doors are slamming, the first thing you want to say is, oh, it's Grandma Tilly, or it's Aunt Jill, or you know, it's somebody in the family that's crossed over. You need to step back and really think about like what's going on and internalize it, and what are the signs? Are you hearing voices? Are you hearing objects being thrown? And would Grandma Tilly really be slamming the door at 3 in the morning? I'm assuming your answer is probably no, she wouldn't be slamming your door at 3 in the morning. I think the hardest part with having attachments or having a haunted house is assuming automatically that it's a family member. Or at least maybe you're in your hopeful mind that it is a family member, because you can't imagine dealing with something else that could potentially be in your house. And so when you get comfortable in your mind that it's a family member, you're not going to deal with it. And basically, you're letting whatever it is harbor in your house eternally. And this thing slowly feeds off of energy and it grows stronger and stronger. And pretty soon it goes from this like friendly haunt, maybe Grandma Tilly, to all of a sudden doors are slamming at 3 a.m, glasses are bursting, someone's running up and down the stairs at all hours of the night, and the haunt just gets worse and worse and worse. And all of a sudden you find yourself on my channel watching this video. I mean, usually haunts are progressive. It's really rare when something just starts out really bad, unless you're moving into a location that's really haunted. But you know, I've done so much work with like haunted places and haunted people that I'm trying to really just go off of my knowledge, because having a haunted house or feeling like you're haunted can really be terrifying. It can make you not function properly. It can make you not be able to go to work because you're tired day in and day out. And really, claiming your house is haunted or you're haunted, it's not something that a lot of people are willing to just walk down the street and say, I have a ghost in my house, because they're worried about the reaction they're going to get from other people thinking that they're crazy. And lucky for us, being in 2016, the veil to the other side has lifted or is lifting so much. You know, and all of these paranormal shows are coming out that I don't understand why we're even saying it's, you know, are you crazy? It's a scary thing. Like, I don't understand why we're even having that discussion still, because I really feel like we have kind of proven in our society of our time that, yeah, there's some fake shows out there, but paranormal, generally speaking, is a real thing. There's hundreds, thousands, millions of people across the world that have experienced haunts or their family that's crossed over. And I think it's silly at this point in time to continue to say, am I crazy? Am I making this up in my head? Because the answer is no, you're not making it up in your head. The biggest thing I've noticed with working with people that have haunted houses is they just want to be listened to. They just want to be told that you're going to be okay. Yes, what you're experiencing is real, but the longer you put off dealing with it, the harder it's going to be to get rid of. Realistically speaking, Grandma Tilly is not the one slamming the door at 3 a.m. So I'm just going to share some of my experiences with you guys, both from living in haunted locations when I was a younger child, going to haunted locations that I've experienced. And I'm not talking about historical places, I'm talking about places that I've had to smudge, you know, people's houses. And then even the experiences that I've had with my family. So most of you guys know about, you know, my aunt has crossed over, my grandmother has crossed over, my cousin has crossed over. Like, I've had, you know, some really important people in my life that have crossed over. And I can tell you what it's like when each of them are around. My grandmother was obsessed with the salon when she was alive. She was very girly. She was all about feminism. She was about hair and nails and makeup. And so when my grandmother comes around, it is instant, I mean, in your face, perm solution. And most guys watching this are gonna be like, I have no idea what that is. But girls, if you've been in a salon, most every female has smelled perm solution. It is that pungent smell of like, it stinks. I mean, really it does. And my grandmother used to get perms. She used to get perms all the time. And so when my grandma comes around, it's in your face perm solution. In fact, I've gotten to the point where I am like almost not immune to the smell, but it doesn't make me cringe like it would if you weren't used to smelling it. My aunt crossed over just about 4 or 5 years ago. My aunt, she died from, she had emphysema. She had, my aunt passed, you know, she had emphysema, she had congestive heart failure. It's basically like your heart explodes. She wasn't in pain, she went really fast. But she not only was a smoker her whole life, but she was also a drinker. And she only drank beer, but I don't know if any of you guys have ever been around somebody that drinks a lot. Especially like if they wake up and drink till like they go to bed. That was how my aunt was. And she had that like sour beer smell. Like, I know that sounds really gross and it's like not something you want to like picture, but that sour scent, when my aunt comes around, it's either the sour beer smell, I can smell her cigarettes, Or she would try to like cover her alcohol breath from the family by eating a lot of cinnamon candy. And I mean, like, it was so much cinnamon candy, like you could smell my aunt a mile away with the cinnamon candy. So sometimes when my aunt comes around, you can also smell the cinnamon candy. My cousin that just passed, he literally just crossed over. And notice my terminology. I don't like to say my family is dead. My family has died. I always say that they've crossed over because I just don't believe this is the end. I do believe in like reincarnation and stuff, but not to the point where you like die and immediately get thrown into another body. But I know that this isn't the end, whether, you know, heaven exists or just the other side. I think it's just another realm of existence. So I always use the terminology, my family crossed over. My cousin passed and I actually haven't had a ton of interaction with him, like coming around scent-wise or anything. My cousin seems to be more comfortable visiting me in my dreams. And I'll wake up and have like the most vivid dream. And sometimes we were much closer when we were kids and he'll take me back to like moments when we were children. And just, you know, things I don't really clearly remember as an adult, but then in my dream, it's like, oh, it all comes back to me. Now, Christian, I know I've talked about Christian. He just died a year ago. He was my boyfriend from like 7th and 8th grade. He was a really big part of my life. We stayed friends for all these years. Christian can manipulate the radio and can play songs. And I'll be sitting at this exact desk editing for, you know, work or a job or something. And my iPhone will turn on and it'll start playing a song from 1998, 1999, Blink-182, Limp Bizkit, something like that. Or even the radio will start like making weird like DJ noise, like, you know. So that's usually Christian. Now, all of these people I just talked about, when they come around, they don't really stay that long. I'm gonna be perfectly honest. They don't, it's not even like for an hour at a time. It's like for maybe 10 minutes at the most. And usually it's, my grandma is really the only one that hangs out that much. I have lived in some haunted houses. My aunt's house was very haunted. We didn't really live there, but I do think that was family that lived there. That house was so old. I think I've told you guys that it's been in the family for like generations and generations. Where my aunt's house was located, it was like the very first house on in this whole like area. And it was built, and my grandfather, it was like a great grandfather, was a contractor. And so I think that the family, like past generations of people that I've never even met, I think they had a really hard time letting go of that house. I think they've crossed over for sure, but I think they just came back often to the house because still to this day, one of my uncles owns that house. That house has just been in our family for generations. When I was about 14, I believe, or maybe 15, my mother and I moved into this house. And it was a pretty decent sized house. And in Colorado, there are basements because you get tornado warnings sometimes. It's really rare a tornado will touch down in Denver, like the metro area. Most of the time, the tornadoes are on the east side of Colorado, like the actual east side of the state. And but they still do build basements in most houses in case there's a tornado. And so this house had a basement. It was a full finished basement. And my mom, I was, you know, in my teens, and so she made the decision to basically give me the basement, and I kind of had my own apartment. So it was a 2-bedroom, 1-bath with like a living room, little dining area. And we had it all snazzed up, and the bigger bedroom in the basement was my bedroom. I mean, it had carpet. It was like an apartment. It had its own exit, actually. I didn't really use it very often, but we had, you know, the second bedroom down there. And basically, when I'd have, like, sleepovers with my girlfriends or if my cousins would come stay the night, that would be the room we had set up for, you know, whoever was the guest. And we didn't keep a lot in there. There was, like, a full-size bed. And then on the other wall, there was like a twin bed in case there was multiple people. And then, you know, there were pictures on the walls, and there was, like, a TV, and, like, I think back then maybe, like, a VCR or maybe a DVD player. And, I mean, we made it homey, of course, but there was something about that room that I hated going in there. I remember being 14, 15. This is even before my grandmother died. There was just something about that room that it just, like, I felt like I shouldn't go in there. Like, there was some energy in there that would tell me, like, that wasn't my space. And I didn't really, you know, tell myself to be afraid of it. I just stayed out of there. And then when I had, like, friends and, you know, family that would stay the night, they didn't want to stay in that room. Like, most of the time when my friends would come over, they'd sleep on the couch or they would just share my bed or my cousins or whatever. And it... Even my cousins were like, no, I don't want to stay in that room. I don't know what it is. And it was just weird. It was just like the feeling of the air, the energy. I do remember being a kid and I would like leave the door shut 90% of the time because that's how it felt. Like I needed to keep it shut. Like I shouldn't be in there. And sometimes, you know, there was a closet in there and I think we stored like craft supplies in the closet. And we lived there for a few years, like maybe 4 years or something like that. And we kept crafts in there. So if I would need something, I'd have to go in that closet. And sometimes I'd leave the door cracked or open because I would be going in and out. And I would either hear the door slam shut or you would just hear it close. And I just remember like being so confused because we're in the basement. We never like kept the windows open in the basement and there was no breeze, and where this bedroom was located, it wasn't near the exit. And I just remember I always kept that door shut. Like even if I had to go in there, I would go in really fast and I'd come back out. Later on, my grandmother was living with us in that house, and you guys know the story. My grandmother passed away in the hospital, and then she came to visit me in that house, and that was my very first paranormal experience, like full on. That was my, you know, my grandma who's passed on. You know, I kind of accepted the paranormal after that, but I still didn't mess with whatever was in that room. So now moving on, I was 18, I moved out, I had a boyfriend long term, moved out with him for a couple of years, and then I was like 20 or something, and I called my mom and I was like, my lease is ending and we're breaking up, and I don't know if you want to like get a bigger house with me, because she was living in like an apartment, and I said we could like share a townhouse or something, and my mom was like, yeah, that sounds like a plan. My lease ends at the same time, I was gonna move back home. So my mom was working a lot at that time, and I was like partially in college, partially working as a hairstylist. And my mom didn't have a lot of time to go with me to look for rental properties. And I was a dumbass 20-year-old that like had no idea what I was looking for or what we needed. And I remember the housing market in Denver at the time was really weird. There just wasn't, for some reason, a lot of rentals available. So I basically had to not worry about what we really wanted. And we just had to find somewhere quick because we didn't want to renew our leases. So I remember I found this place and it rented really fast, and I was upset because I was like, where are we going to live? And then all of a sudden, somehow I found this other townhouse, and for some reason it was really, really cheap for the rent. And so I called the landlord or property manager, whoever she was, and I said, I'd like to come take a look at this townhouse and you know, why is it so inexpensive for the area and for Colorado and stuff? And she never really gave me an answer. She's like, why don't you come look at the property first and then you can make your decision. So I drove over to this townhouse, and the area was huge. Like the townhomes were huge. They were like the size of a 3-story house. So I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I couldn't believe the size of this place. And I called my mom. I was like, I don't know what to do. We don't really have a lot of options. And my mom was like, put my name on it, just sign the lease. And you know, whatever. If you say it's nice, then let's go for it. About a month later, we were moving in. And The layout of the house or the townhome was really weird. You drove into the garage, which was on the very bottom floor. You'd park the garage in the garage, and then you would walk inside, and it would be like the basement level. And it was like a rec room, a really big rec room, and it was finished. And then it had like the little laundry room off to the side. And then in order to go upstairs to like the main floor, you had to turn this corner and you had to go up this really steep, long staircase because this place was huge. So the first thing we noticed after we moved in, and honestly, I can't tell you the day of moving, you know, if you guys have ever moved, you're not paying attention to little details and stuff because you're moving and you're tired and you're hot and you're stressed and you're crabby and whatever. So after we moved in, this hallway, when you would walk upstairs to this hallway, now take in mind the location of this hallway was like in the direct middle of the house and there's no windows, nothing. And you'd walk up this long, steep, narrow hallway of stairs and you would just get hit with this huge gust of wind. I mean, to the point where like your hair would start like flying all over. You know, I remember testing it. Sometimes it would happen and sometimes it wouldn't. And I remember thinking maybe I'm just running up the stairs really fast or maybe I'm running down the stairs really fast. And it always would just happen at sporadic times. So now the main floor was like a really huge kitchen. It was like a master bedroom was on this floor with a master bath. And then a really big living room, and then the front door went out onto this greenery grass area. And the reason the house or the townhome was set that way was it was up on a hill, so you drive into, you know, the basement floor, and that's really your front door, but technically you have another front door. The next thing that we started noticing, I had a cat named Max. I told you guys about my black cat that lived to be like 18. He was my baby. One day my mom and I were cooking in the kitchen. We heard a bunch of cat toys moving. Like if you guys have cats, like sometimes they have like bells, or sometimes they have like roly plastic little ball things where they play with them. And we hear like a bunch moving, and my mom and I were like, oh good, Max must be comfortable with his new house. And we walked around the corner and there's like six cat toys, like cat balls and bells and all this stuff. And they're all rolling around by themselves around Max. Like an entity was playing with Max with these cat toys or something. And oddly, I guess at that point, like my mom and I hadn't really addressed ghosts and paranormal together at that point. I remember we looked at each other because we realized, you know, we'd both just saw this. And instead of saying anything, we just looked at each other and turned around and walked out of the room. Like, we didn't know how to respond to each other when you see something like that. And so time went on, and I had the third floor, which was a giant, I mean, it was the strangest house. Like, this, the whole third floor was a bedroom. It was, like, as big as, like, Carrie Bradshaw's apartment in the Manhattan movie, like, Sex and the City. I mean, it was huge, like a walk-in closet. It was giant. And I remember I just hated being there. And not too long after we moved in, I never really had anything happen up there. There was something about it. I just didn't feel comfortable. So I had, you know, some girlfriends that had their own places, especially at that age, you're like in and out of the house a lot. So I was kind of staying with my girlfriends a lot, mainly because I didn't feel comfortable there. And the more I was gone, the more my mom would call me and be like, you've got to come home. I hate this house. I can't be in here by myself. And so I'd have to go home, and like it'd be the point where I had like a couch in my bedroom and she'd crash on my couch. Sometimes I would sleep in the living room, so I was close to her master bedroom. But my mom was seeing a man in a top hat in all of the reflections of like the mirrors and the reflections of like the glass doors and the windows. She knew he was like seeing her. One night she called me and she was crying, and she said that she was watching it. She saw this thing come through one of our mirrors that we had hung up, and it like went from looking like an 1800s man with a top hat, and all of a sudden he turned into like a skeleton. like a kind of a scary skeleton face. And she's like, I'm done. I can't live here. I can't do this anymore. Another thing that had happened since we'd moved in was we started finding pennies everywhere. And I'm not talking like one or two pennies. There was one day we came home and there was just pennies up and down the stairs. And we don't collect pennies, so I mean, where the hell did all these pennies come from? And we would collect them, and then if it would get full, we'd go like turn them in for money, and it just pennies were showing up everywhere. We were there for like a month, and then my mom was like, I'm calling the property manager. So my mom called the woman and she was like, I mean, I think we know why the house was so inexpensive to rent. There's something going on here and we can't live like this. Like, we can't function like this. And basically the property manager answered her by saying, when will you be out? And just let me know and leave the keys on the front porch. And we thought that was so strange. Like, we didn't understand it. So we were there for 30 days exactly. And we left on, you know, like the second month started and we were moving out. Like, we couldn't have gotten out of there any faster. It was one of those situations. And we ended up seeing a neighbor for the first time since we'd moved in. And it was the day we were leaving. One of the last like moving trips, you know, that we had with the U-Haul. And the neighbor was like, we don't know what's wrong with that house, but everybody that moves in can't stay there. They like can't live there. So that was weird. So that's my story of living with a haunted house. And it's, I never really saw anything like my mom did, you know, but I did the breezes and like we would hear doors slam shut once in a while, and there wasn't really a lot of doors in that house. We didn't know where that was coming from. So I really get what it's like. It can be quite stressful living somewhere where you feel like you're surrounded by things you don't want to be surrounded by. So my first key is stop saying it's your family. I hope for your sake that your family's visits, but I don't think it's somebody that's going to be stomping up and down the stairs trying to get your attention. One of the other things that can really contribute to causing yourself more problems if you think your house is haunted is being fearful. The number one way to give an energy more energy or electromagnetic fields is by getting scared, right, or surprised. So that's what they want you to do. They want to scare you so that you have instant reaction, right? If someone goes boo, ah, you're like, you know, you emit this energy, right? We can't see it. It's this invisible field that we're emitting it from. Even if you get mad, it takes time to like well up, right, and like get mad. But to scare somebody, it's instant. So of course they're going to scare you. They want that energy. They use that energy like batteries. They drain you so that they can manifest or make more noises or get your attention or whatever they're trying to do. So the number one thing I always say is stand your ground. Don't be fearful. And that's because they want that energy. If you yell and you get angry, they're going to use that energy. And if you get scared, they're going to use that energy. Once again, going back to why would you let a stranger stay in your house? I don't care if they're alive or dead. You should never let a stranger live or stay in your house. You know, whether you're a homeowner or just someone that rents a property, you have to put your foot down. Like, you can't, don't expect an energy to leave because you're like praying to Jesus or praying to God. I'm not saying those things don't work. I'm just saying that you have to address it individually, with or without a name. If your neighbor that you really can't stand came in your house, would you let them stay there? Or would you say, I need you to go. You have to go. You know, that's what you need to do. You don't have to address it by the name, but you can say, whatever energy is here, I pay rent here. I pay mortgage here. This is my house and you're not welcome and you have to go. You cannot stay. You are not allowed to stay. You know, you have to basically set up rules and boundaries for your own house and say, you have to go. And it's going to take more than once. That's the very first thing. That's the first lesson, is if you're trying to get something out of your house, tell it to go. It's as simple as that. Don't let it stay there. But you have to say it with like umph. Like you can't sound weak voiced. You know, just like use it and address it as if a stranger were in your house. You know, if you have 3 kids that are asleep that are all under the age of 8 and you feel fear for their safety because you have an entity in the house, I mean, and you would you let a stranger come in with your kids asleep? No. You're going to tell them, get the F out. I'm not saying use that terminology. I'm not saying get angry with it. But you have to tell it. You have to go. You are not welcome here. You are not welcome in this house. This is my house. And that's setting up the boundaries. Because if you don't say anything, you're just like, I'm crazy. Oh, I'm scared. You're just letting it billow up. You're giving it more energy for it to manifest, get stronger, and eventually it's going to just take the whole house over. I like the term malicious spirits because that kind of covers everything that's basically unwanted. I don't like to say evil or demons or just angry. It's just malicious because something can get attached to you and follow you home that isn't a demon, that's not angry. It just, there's something about different vibrations of people where a ghost, like let's just say the casinos, right? Like in Vegas, I've been followed home from casinos. They're so old, they have so much history. There was a lot of death that happened in Vegas, especially back in the day. Like there's something about an energy that just is attracted to your energy. It's like a battery, like a positive negative side to a battery, a positive negative side to a magnet. It's just going to click, and you're walking through being innocent, not ghost hunting, not doing anything you're not supposed to do, and an energy just happens to come along and say, you know what, I like their energy, I'm gonna go along with them. Or maybe they know that you're spiritual, or maybe they know you're psychic, and they're gonna connect with you on that level. The only way energies are gonna stay in your house is if you let them, is really what it comes down to. A big misconception I get is, if my house is haunted, do I need to have it exorcised? No, not unless you live in Amityville, and I think that's even clear at this point. First step, haunted house, haunted person, tell it to go, tell it to leave. Say it with umph in your voice. You're gonna have to do it more than once. And you can't do it later. You can't, like, if something happens and a dish flies across the room, you can't, you know, 5 hours later discuss it with your husband and then say you need to go. You've gotta address it as it's happening. No, whoever did that, you're not allowed to break stuff in my house. Get out of my house. You're not allowed to stay here. You're not supposed to be here. Because family wouldn't be breaking your stuff. Another big misconception is people think that if a door slams and a bowl slams down on the ground and breaks, or glass breaks, yes, that is considered poltergeist activity. But does poltergeist automatically mean it's a demon? No, it doesn't. In fact, I've known people that haven't had attachments at all, and their energy is so on the edge that sometimes your energy can cause like house movement or doors to slam. Seriously, I've seen that happen. That's getting in another realm of stuff. But just remember that don't be fearful of words and terminology just because Hollywood has educated you guys on the movie Poltergeist. That doesn't mean that's what's going on in your house. If telling it to go does not work, you're gonna have to step up your game. You're gonna have to start with one thing at a time. And the next thing that I would suggest is smudging. You have to research smudging. There's like 1,400 different ways to do it. But I'll show you guys how I do it. So I use, it's kind of like a little pearl conch, I guess. I actually received this as a gift from someone that's within the Cherokee Indian tribe that knows me. And it actually has pearl on the inside, but it's been blessed by a shaman that's within the Cherokee Nation. And so this was given to me as a gift. It's kind of holy as far in the realm of, you know, Cherokee religion. And I was also sent an eagle feather, which I'm not going to show on here just because it's a little bit sacred. You're not supposed to buy eagle feathers or steal eagle feathers. It was given to me on the reservation, so please make sure that that's clear. It wasn't and they use feathers that have mulched. It's not like they're picking feathers off of eagles. So please don't be dumb and take my words wrong or go do something stupid. Remember, these animals are very sacred, especially to, you know, Native Americans. But so I will fill this conch with white sage, and I'll go around with the white sage and the eagle feather, and you kind of go in this motion, and it just causes the smudging to go larger and larger, and you're kind of evaporating it through the air throughout the house. There's a couple of different kinds of sage you can get. They have the bundles of sage, which are about like this, The size of a bundle will cost you about $3 to $6. Usually they'll sell them at any sort of, you know, do you have like a psychic store near you, or a new age store, or something like that. This is the bundle. And then I actually have a ton of like loose sage. And I think I got this when I was given the conch. So this is probably blessed sage. And it's loose pieces and it's just like this, you can kind of see it. And so I will fill up the conch with just loose sage, it's white sage, and light the conch full of the sage, and that's it. Be careful, obviously, lighting it. You don't want to like set yourself on fire or anything. I'm not here to like educate you on not being a pyromaniac, but you know, just be safe with it. Remember, this can get really smoky and you don't want to set off alarms in your house or anyone else's for that matter. There are so many ways to do smudging. I can't even tell you guys. I don't do smudging the exact same way every single time. You know, you're going to find on some websites that it says to go clockwise. Some say counterclockwise. I've done every way in between. I don't really see, I mean, I've never done, you know, a statistical value on this, you know, when I do it clockwise, this is when the percentage that it works, and counterclockwise, this is the percentage that it works. I'll go through the house, if it's someone I'm doing it for, or I've smudged my house before, and I'll find like one of the main rooms, which is usually like the kitchen or the living room or the dining room. And if there's a bigger window, whatever the bigger window is, I'll open up the window and leave the screen on. And basically, that is the energy's exit point to leave. There's something about the smudge that they just don't like. This is sacred Native American way of ridding your house of they used to call it evil spirits, but you don't have to be evil to rid your home of something you don't want. So once you open one of the windows, before you even start the smudge, you say basically to the energies, anything in here, I want you to understand that this is your exit point and your only exit point. The rest of the house is completely sealed up. And basically they have to leave through the window. You can open the screen if you want to be, you know, that more dramatic. I've never really needed the screen open. And basically I'll start in the house, and I do everything from inside of the oven to inside of all of the kitchen cabinets to even inside of the silverware drawers. You'll go inside of the garage. I've done attics, but I don't think it's really necessary unless you're having activity up there. But you go through every single corner of the house except for the room that has the open window. And so you're basically forcing the energy out of the house by doing one section at a time, and it has nowhere to go. It's basically winding down on having not a lot of places to hide from you. So now when I'm smudging, depends on the haunt. Most of the time I'm just going to use like the St. Michael prayer. I don't know if you guys are religious or not. I've told you before, I don't have a specific religion that I follow, but St. Michael is like what I use for smudging or ridding energies. So if you go to any sort of religious stores, Catholic stores, sometimes even metaphysical stores, they're gonna have these cards that are St. Michael cards. Okay, these are the plastic ones. Sometimes they have the paper ones. There's a few different ways to say the St. Michael prayer. It's actually more powerful if you take the prayer and then kind of morph it into something of your own, because you're you know, reciting this prayer in like the name of the divine. But Saint Michael is known for basically being the demon hunter of the archangels, so that's why he's like a protective guardian. I also have Saint Michael candles. These are $1 at the grocery store. Honestly, they have these at most grocery stores. They're $1 each, and before I start the smudging, I will light a bunch of these throughout the house. Obviously you want them to be in a safe spot. On the back of them, it does also say the St. Michael prayer. You don't want to carry these around though, because you don't want to like drop it and light something on fire. But this is basically, it's me calling upon St. Michael to come down and help protect the house and basically prepare me for kind of a spiritual war that I'm about to start. You can have another investigator follow you with a digital recorder. You can have someone follow you with a video camera. I've had both of those done before. You do usually end up getting evidence, but you need to be more focused about doing the smudging and cleansing properly versus trying to be on camera and presenting yourself as a lead investigator. That needs to not be your priority. You have to make sure you cleanse properly, thoroughly. It takes a long time to go through each room, through cabinets, through, you know, closets, every like door you can think of. It has to be done properly and thoroughly, because if you leave an area that's unsmudged, that can be a crevice that they can basically hide and harbor. And usually they get really angry if that happens, and activity can pick up really, really bad once if the smudging goes away. The smudging doesn't last forever. It's a temporary fix, and it's something, sometimes it'll work in one time, but most of the time I've found that not to be the case. You have to do it maybe once a week. If it's a severe haunt, you're gonna have to do it every few days. And remember, this could take an hour or two for the whole process. And this is just basically keeping the smudge up that just keeps the house and the air clear and cleansed of the energies that are negative that you don't want to be around. Why does this work? It's said that the smudge and the smoke, like the smell of the sage, that the entities don't like this. There's something about the healing energy of the sage and the scent and the smell and what it creates in the air on a different plane or whatever that they don't like, and it runs them out. So you might have to redo it again and again and again and again. One question I always get is, before I smudge, should I investigate to make sure something's here? In my opinion, because I've done it myself, the biggest mistake anyone can make is investigating their house. Because the minute you break out all your ghost gear, professional or not, doesn't matter, that energy is going to think that you want to communicate with it, and it's going to harbor and once again fester because it's gaining energy because you're communicating with it, and it thinks that you want it there now because you're talking to it and you're getting evidence through it. And it's just gonna continue to get stronger. So the biggest mistake you can make is investigating your house. I always say absolutely not. Should you call paranormal investigators into your house? You can, but I mean, don't be surprised if the energy doesn't get, you know, start picking up again for the same reason. Make sure that you have someone that's available to smudge the house immediately after, or, you know, within a day or so after. I've never investigated my home in Vegas, and it will never be investigated in. Sure, I've played with my cameras and stuff, but I've never investigated in my house. You cannot open that door because it's a revolving door, and when it revolves, it just keeps getting bigger. It never shuts, never closes. It just keeps going around and around. Biggest mistake you can do is investigate your house. So as you're smudging, now if you're dealing with something that's darker, and I'm talking about something that's been scratching, hitting, poking, causing things to bleed, whatever, objects breaking, whether it's glasses and dinerware, maybe knives are being astray, you're gonna probably have to bring in like the Lord's Prayer and like some more intense, in-depth prayers, whatever your background is in religion. What happens if you're an atheist and or an agnostic? What do I do? There's still probably some spiritual stuff out there that you can use, but then you're gonna have to call someone else in to do it for you, basically. I've never seen a house cleansed that wasn't like in the name of something like of the better, of good, of God, of archangels, whatever. And you may not believe in that, and that's okay, but I don't know how. Of course, if you're atheist or agnostic, would you believe in ghosts anyways? That's a good question. If you don't really believe in the other side, why would you believe in ghosts? So I don't know. That's another question that I don't really have the answer to that. When I smudge or cleanse people's houses, I require them to be there because they also have to put their foot down with the energy while I'm doing the smudging. Because it's not, you know, I can smudge and I can recite the St. Michael's Prayer and do this and that as much as I want, but at the end of the day, it's not my house. And the owners need to be there to reiterate what I'm saying. And once again, you have to say it with that gut. You can't be here. I said, you can't be here in the name of St. Michael or whatever. If you're religious, use that. You just can't say it weak. You can't be like, please go. No, you don't ask it to go. You tell it to go. There is no asking. You don't ask a stranger to leave your house. You tell the stranger to leave your house. And you can get on eBay and order stuff or even Amazon. So since frankincense, if you guys have ever heard of it, you spell it frankincense. So they have frankincense oil, and it's literally usually shipped in this little guy. It's not a whole ton of oil. Frankincense is a scent that entities hate, especially usually malicious ones, meaning something that you don't want in your home. So to give you an idea of what it smells like, I mean, I guess like if you ever dealt with essential oils, it's very like woodsy. It's just like a woodsy sort of scent. So frankincense essential oils, you can put this, like, you know, I have this little essential oil machine here, but you can also kind of wear it as like a perfume. Like if you're getting scratched at home and stuff like that, they hate the scent of frankincense. When I've suggested people to use this as like a perfume or whatever, they don't get scratched when they use this. This is not a permanent solution though. Like you need to get it out of your house. And, but this will help like if you're getting physically assaulted, basically. They make all kinds of stuff. They make frankincense incense. I actually have like a powder form frankincense. And so what I will do with this is, it's just frankincense, the same stuff. It's just finely kind of chopped. Can you guys see that? It's just very tiny little grainy frankincense. And so if someone's having like a really dark haunt in their house or something's going on, I will sprinkle some of the frankincense on top of the white sage when I burn it. And that's basically to emit the scents of not only white sage, but frankincense into the air. So you can order that online too, eBay or Amazon. Another one that's funny is, because you've probably heard of this on Vampire Diaries, but this is vervain. And it's real. It's a real, for alchemists, they actually use this. The vervain I actually will mix with the white sage as well. This is kind of in chunky form. They make it in essential oil form and all that stuff. But it rids off really dark stuff, evil stuff usually. So this isn't like pulled out unless we think something really bad's going on. These are only two items out of, God knows how many that you can order online. I'm not fully educated on all this stuff. I actually have to say that the frankincense thing, I learned from Billy. Billy was teaching me about frankincense. One time when I was up at the Stanley Hotel with GAC, with Ghost Adventures, Billy, I was telling him about a case I was working on and he was like, frankincense, frankincense. So, you know, they know about this too. They just don't talk about this stuff. This hasn't been as accepted into the paranormal community / society as just plain ghost hunting. But yeah, this is what the guys use too. And Billy's told me that he used this all over his house and essential oils and stuff to try and rid his house. Especially if you have kids around and stuff like that. Now, what do you do if like, Crystal, I've tried smudging, I've done all this stuff and nothing is working. What do I do? Well, first of all, I'm gonna ask you, are you sure that you're saying it with power? Are you sure you're telling it to go? Are you sure you're being consistent with smudging? The next step is you're gonna have to probably call in some sort of a psychic, and I'm not trying to sound like Amy Allen. But, you know, and if you call in a psychic, you need to really make sure you're at that point. Like, you need to really make sure that this is out of my control, I can't handle it. There's all kinds of different psychics, and I don't even know all of them. You're gonna have to get online and seriously Google the different kinds that there are. But you do need to keep in mind that when researching a psychic, especially if there's one in your hometown or wherever you're at, make sure they're a legitimate person, because there's a lot of illegitimate psychics out there. So try to see if they have reviews online. Make sure that they have legit like customers and followers online. everything's on the internet nowadays. So if they're fake, they're not gonna, you know, you have to use the internet anymore for, you know, to develop a business. So, and even if they work outside of like a new age store or a psychic store, usually those people will have like psychic events and stuff. And if they do, try to go meet the psychics before you actually hire one to come in your house. Now, when you get to this point, when you feel like you need to have a psychic come in, you need to see if they're like clairvoyant. There's just so many different kinds. I don't really have a specific kind to suggest to you. I'll just say find a psychic that thinks they can help you cleanse the house. I used to know a lady in Colorado that I would forward people to. She would go in, and I think she was clairvoyant, so she would be able to communicate with who or whatever was there. And she would help them do another kind of clearing session and basically tell it to go. That doesn't always work either. So what happens, like, if you've smudged, you've done all this stuff, you've told it to leave, you've used frankincense, they even have frankincense candles. Like, do whatever you can, you know, to try to rid this, and you're like, it's still not working, now what do I do? Yep, you're gonna have to go to like a priest or a rabbi or even just someone that's ordained. So Blake and I, we found ourselves doing some house cleanses for people, and we both decided to get ordained. There's something called the Universal Life Church that you can get ordained through. But I mean, I wouldn't suggest someone that like really doesn't believe in God or they're like agnostic or something to go get their ministry when they find it bullshit, because it's still not gonna work for you. Just because you have a card that says you're ordained and a minister doesn't mean you really are. And it's not like I practice religion like that, but I do have a strong faith. So I think that when I smudge, that's why I'm able to get rid of it for people easier. And Blake is actually really into the ordained stuff. He really, he's done a lot of smudging. He knows a lot of prayers by heart. We don't go to church. Like I said, it's just something that he's used as his tool for the industry that we're in. So you need to get online and see, not just, you don't have to go to your local church. That is an option. Sometimes through these Universal Life churches, they do have lists of people in your local area that are ordained, or ministers or both, that can come in and basically help try to do this house cleansing. Not everybody does it. Technically, yeah, it is like exercising your house. They can bring holy water. They don't have to. I don't ever suggest anyone bring holy water into their own house. If you think you have something that bad in your house, the last thing I would tell you to do is bring in holy water. And that's because priests or ministers or whoever, if they're bringing in holy water to try and rid something that's dark or possibly demonic, the first person that's gonna get hurt is usually the priest or the minister or whatever. And that's because, of course, it's a fallen angel or darkness. They don't want to go to the light. They don't want to be pushed out. They don't want to cross over. And the person that's the strongest in the room on the God side is the minister or the priest. So, of course, that's who's going to get attacked. I've seen it happen. People, you know, that I've known that I've had to, I've only had really two cases that I've had to push with a minister. And it sucks when you're in that point. And these people were like, they looked like zombies because they weren't sleeping because their house was so haunted. There are ways to get rid of it, but you have to be consistent with it. And the biggest thing that I've seen with haunted homes or haunted people, if it doesn't come from you, if you're not the one saying, go, get out of my house, it's not gonna leave. Don't expect someone else, a psychic, a minister, or even a paranormal investigator to come in your house and rid it for you without you contributing, because it won't work. It'll never work. So you need to get the confidence up. Don't feel stupid that you feel like you're talking to yourself. No, I'm just talking to some stupid ghost in my house. Get out of my house, ghost. You have to take it serious. Or, you know, if you think that you're faking this and you're making all this shit up in your head, that there's like doors slamming shut and glasses are breaking, okay, then you're making it up in your head. But if you're wanting to get sleep again and keep your family safe, then take this serious and get it out of your house and stop using the excuse that it's in your head, because it's not in your head. You're not making it up. But you're the most powerful tool for yourself to get rid of something like that. So the next question is, what if I have an attachment from somewhere? I went to an investigation and came home with this attachment, or I decided to be an idiot and I dabbled in black magic and I got an attachment from it. I mean, some things, like what I think would happen with Jay and Ashley, which is so sad, I told you I don't think they're going to be able to get resolvement unless they find someone that's either a current Satanist or a past Satanist that can close that up. And I mean, I don't know any of those people. You know, I've never met one of those. Act responsibly is the biggest advice I can give you guys. Don't go out and provoke stuff. Didn't you learn from Zach Bagans? Like, his house is so haunted. He had a dungeon. He's been pulled out of bed. He's been scratched. He can't hold a relationship down. Jay and his wife just broke up. Aaron and his wife broke up. Act responsibly. That's really what it comes down to. If you don't want an attachment, there's one thing where it's like innocent. I was at the grocery store and something followed me home. That can happen. But there's another side where it's like I provoked. I was an idiot. I went into a demonic house and told it to come up out of that ground and get me. Yeah, well then you probably deserve to be followed home if you're gonna act like a jackass. I've had things follow me and it sucks. So don't act like an idiot, you know, if that's what you did to get this attachment. You have to respect this realm as if they were real. If they're real enough to follow you home and make your life hell, then it's real enough to treat them with respect and not taunt and not provoke. The worst attachments I've ever seen when having to cleanse a house is people that have provoked things. And it's people that go into places like, I don't believe you. I don't believe in ghosts. You're stupid. Ghosts are stupid. Oh yeah, if you're real, you just follow me home. And that entity's like, okay, thanks for the invite. And I've had people like, that's another way to get attachments, is actually inviting them. Like Zach, he had a dungeon. He's like, giving them a place to harbor in his basement. Okay, so don't tell me that you got pulled out of bed at 5 a.m. Like, that sucks for you, but then don't have a place for them to live. Like, I think he did an interview. I remember it said something like he told them that if they followed him home, he didn't care as long as they stayed in the dungeon. What if a haunt is bothering kids or animals? Shut that shit down. I don't like that. If there's two things I don't like at all, it's when kids get picked on from ghosts and it's when animals get picked on from ghosts. And you need to put your foot down. Do not allow it to happen. Those kids and those animals cannot speak for themselves and you're their voice, so get it out. Hopefully this answered some of your questions. Oh man, it can get intense. Ghost hunting's no joke. Like, there's so many different pieces and aspects to being a paranormal investigator, so act responsibly. But most of all, if you're a stranger watching this video, put your foot down. Don't let it stay in your house. Tell it to go. Tell it to go to the light. Tell it to go to God. Tell it to go back where it came from. Tell it to go anywhere but here, you know, and that usually works pretty easy, but you have to do it in degrees. Like, it's a buildup. It depends, you know, you have to, if this doesn't work, we go to the next step, next step, next step. And there's other people out there that might do things differently than me. I'm not saying my way is the all saint way of doing it. It's just the way that I have seen results. You know, that's how I train people, strangers, when they call me and say I have a ghost in my house or something and I want to get rid of it. So I make them do part of the work first. And then when it gets to a point where I don't think they can handle it, then I will step in. But you can do this. Don't feel weak. Don't feel alone. Don't talk yourself out of what's going on in your house, and don't convince yourself that it's Grandma Nelly, because it's not. You gotta face the music. It's a stranger, and even if it is Grandma Nelly in your house, tell her she can't be doing that at 3 a.m. Say, Grandma Nelly, you're allowed to visit my house from 8 a.m. till 3 p.m, and that's when I'm open for business, and if you can't come then, sorry, you can't come at 3 a.m. Seriously, you've got to put your foot down with the whole enchilada. Thank you for watching my video. Thank you for giving me such good ideas on topics to chat about. Please give my video a thumbs up because you love me so much. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. Make sure you leave me comments below on if you have experienced smudging or if you have experienced getting rid of entities. Let me know your ideas. And I'm always open to chatting about it. I love hearing from you guys. So make sure you subscribe and I will catch you guys next time. We're back from dead. From the dead.